Hello, welcome. I believe you're my last barber appointment of the evening. Oh, you just came from the suit shop at 19 Cozy Lane? Yeah, I think that's the finest place to get menswear around. Please have a seat. Make yourself comfortable. Of course, you'll be wanting to spend the night, right? It's too late to find somewhere else, and we have 4 rooms right above us. How about, let me take a look and see what's available. Yes, we have 3 rooms on the floor right above us. 2 of them are occupied right now, and we also have the owl's roost on the 3rd floor, up the spiral stairs. How about you spend the night in there? It's our best room in my opinion. Though, we often have owls nesting and perching right above the 3rd floor in the attic. And they can sometimes make a little bit of a fuss at night. As long as you don't mind the sounds of our feathered visitors. I don't charge more for that room. We have so few rooms already, and I honestly don't think that would be fair. And some of our more frequent visitors, they have a favorite room. And it's not always Owl's Roost. I guess some people don't appreciate our nocturnal guests. Anyway, let me take your coat. For a complimentary steaming to our guests. Most travelers who stop in aren't really expecting to spend the night, and we try to make sure that their clothing more freshened up for the next day. Since most people don't have a spare change of clothes with them. Yeah. Oh. A little bit dry tonight. Well, I've been there before. Nothing but cobwebs in my purse. So don't you worry. I'll take care of you tonight, okay? Alright. So, what can I serve you? We brew our own small batches of beverages, and currently we have a semi-sweet mead. It's made from a wildflower honey I collect from Hushfield's garden. Between numbers 3 and 5 Cozy Lane. Yeah, there's a hive tucked away into a corner, away from the main path. Have you gotten a chance to walk through the garden? It's so pleasant and quiet, I highly recommend it if you haven't yet. It's taken care of by a very old man now, and he lives above the bookstore in number 5. There's also a hermit who lives in the garden. I've only gotten the chance to talk to her once. It's quite a lucky and rare occasion, from what I understand. So, let me serve you some of that meat. It's delicious on ice, or temperature. Here you go. Just put it right here. So, let's get started on your shave. I actually just finished my last open sheaf soap, so I would like to give you the honors of selecting the next one to open. I have 4 different choices here, so let's see. I try to make them out of natural materials. And first we have cedar. It's made from the dried leaves and bark of the tree, crushed up to release oils. Inside. It has a woodsy scent with just a touch of sweetness. I also have clary sage. I'm sure you've smelled regular sage before, right? Yeah. Clary sage, on the other hand, has a bit of a softer scent than regular sage. It smells earthy and floral. Some regular sage growing in the Hushfields garden, but this clary sage I get is imported. Yeah. Then I have bay rum scented soap. It's made from a mixture of the bay leaf and rum, as it's so named. It's very sweet and spicy smelling. I'd say it's quite a favorite. Then there's sandalwood, which I also get imported. In fact, this might actually be the last sandalwood I'll have for a while, since the price has increased quite a bit. And also, from what I understand, the scarcity of the wood. It's very woody smelling, but it also has some other complex notes, which make it a bit exotic. I think it's a fine choice for your soap, since I won't have one for a little while. So let's get started. I tend not to talk much during the actual shaving. I think it's much more enjoyable to sit back and relax and feel the sensations and hear the sounds, instead of someone asking constant questions of how your day is going. You know what I mean? Yeah. Okay. I think that looks good. Maybe so. on this side. Check on that blade. Looks good. The fresh green blade. Let me just wipe the rest of the shaving cream off of your skin. Now for a little aftershave. Really good. You're all done. Fresh and cleanly shaven. So what do you think? You've always wanted a big full beard before? Well, why didn't you mention that before the shave? I did notice a little bit of patchiness before your shave. But I actually have something that can make your beard grow full. No, it's not impossible. Let me take a look. I know I have it tucked away here somewhere. It's not a part of my normal barber's services. No, it's not one of my products. I personally couldn't make something like this, and it's not something you can find easily, which is why I just have this tiny little bottle. I bought it from a traveling peddler who stops by the Horned Owl on rare occasions. She sells a lot of rare and expensive items, and this particular product wasn't cheap, but I made it last for about 5 years now. You only need one single drop per dose, and it's supposed to last for about 10 years. At first, I didn't believe the peddler when she came in with her strange, expensive items, but she took a small red candy from her bag, and she told me, "This little cinnamon candy will change your hair to red for 1 hour." So I took the candy and I unwrapped it from its wrapper, and I tried it. Maybe not the wisest choice to take candy from a stranger, but lo and behold, my hair turned into a bright, fiery red. And she said, "That'll be 1 gold coin. She drove a hard bargain, but she convinced me that day, and I bought this beard growing vial from her. I also bought another vial of something that helps you grow your hair back on your head, but that was used up a lot quicker. So let me serve some of this up for you. How about in a fresh glass of mead? Here you go. It shouldn't take but a single sip to make your beard grow. And I'll clean up here and be back to see the results. Wow, that is the most luscious and plush beard I've seen in a while. I suppose your service needs have changed a little bit, right? I think we can do with a nice shampoo and condition, and maybe a little bit of a trim to shape it up. Yes, it starts with a very rapid growth, as you can see, and then it sort of begins a normal course of growth after right now. Okay. First. Okay. And of course, I need to condition it as well. Conditioning is gonna help make sure it stays nice and soft. Into the ends of the beard, the tips. Now just going to brush it off with this coarse boar hair bristle brush. Really nice. It looks like these mustache hairs grew a lot. Look at this. This wild. We'll definitely trim them down and maybe part them in one direction like that. Yeah, that looks better. Don't brush them in that direction. of length are you thinking? You want it to be pretty long like this, but just cleaned up. Okay, yeah, I like that. I think that's gonna look good. looks so good. Let me apply a little bit of balm. Balm is gonna help nourish it, make it a little bit more softer too. Going to use my fingers. Oh, it smells good. Excellent. Well, let me lead you up to your room, and I can make you a nice hot cup of chamomile tea while you get settled in. Okay, let's go. Put your tea right on the table here. It's pretty mild and lukewarm right now, so you won't be burned if you want to drink it right away, okay? Glad to see you're nice and settled in. I hope you don't mind. The window's open. It's the best way to keep it cool up here and let all the heat escape. How about time? A little bedtime story. A little fairy tale. Okay. 200 or 300 years ago, when people were far from being so crafty and cunning as they are nowadays, an extraordinary event took place in a little town. By some mischance or mistake, one of the great owls, called Horned Owl, had come from the neighboring woods into the barn of one of the townsfolk at night. dare to leave her retreat because she was afraid of the other birds, which raised a terrible outcry on every occasion that she appeared. But then, in the morning, when the manservant went into the barn to fetch some straw, he was so terribly alarmed at the sight of the owl sitting there in the corner that he ran away and announced to his master that a monster, the likes of which he had never seen before in his life, and a monster which could devour a man without any difficulty, was sitting right there in his barn, rolling its eyes about its head. "I know how you are," said the master. "You may have courage enough to chase a blackbird out of the fields, but when you see a dead hen lying on the ground, you have to get a stick before you will even go near it. I must go and see for myself what kind of a monster this is," added the master, and went quite boldly into the barn and looked around. But when he saw the strange and grim creature with his own two eyes, he was just as terrified as the servant, and with two big steps he ran out of there, and he ran right to his neighbors, and he begged them desperately to lend him assistance against the unknown and dangerous beast, or else the whole town might be in terrible danger if it were to break loose out of the barn. A great noise and clamor arose in all of the streets. The townsmen came, armed with spears, hay forks, scythes, axes, as if they were going out against an enemy. And when they had finally all gathered in the marketplace, they marched straight to the barn and surrounded it on all sides. Thereupon, one of the most courageous of them stepped forth and entered with his spear lowered. But he came out running immediately afterwards with a shriek and as pale as death, and he could not utter a single word. Yet two others ventured in, but they fared no better. At last, one stepped forth, a great strong man who was famous for his warlike deeds, and he said, "You will not drive away the monster by merely looking at him. We must be absolutely determined here. But I see that you have all turned into women, and not one of you even dares to encounter the beast." He ordered them to give him some armor, as well as a sword and a spear, and he armed himself. All of them praised his courage, but many also feared for his life. The two barn doors were opened, and they all saw the owl, which in the meantime had perched herself on the middle of a crossbeam in the barn. And he had a ladder brought, and he raised it up. And when he was ready to climb up, all of the townspeople cried out to him that he was to bear himself bravely, and they compared him to Saint George, who slew the dragon. And when he had just got to the top of the ladder, and then the owl perceived that he had his eyes on her, and was also bewildered by the huge crowd around her and all of the shouting, and she knew not how to escape. She rolled her eyes, ruffled her feathers, flapped her wings, snapped her beak, and cried, "Tu-whit, tu-whoo," in a harsh voice. "Strike home, strike home," cried the crowd outside to their valiant hero. "You wouldn't say that if you were standing where I am," answered he. And he tried to plant his foot one rung higher on the ladder, but then he began to tremble, and half fainting, went back down again. Yep. And now, there was no one left who dared put him or herself in such danger. "The monster," said they, "poisoned and mortally wounded the very strongest man among us by snapping at him and just breathing on him. Are we also going to risk our lives?" They all took counsel as to what they ought to do to prevent the whole town from being destroyed by the beast. For a long time, everything seemed to be of no use, but at length, the senator found a solution. "My opinion," said he, "is that we ought, out of the community chest, to pay for this barn, and whatsoever corn, straw, or hay it contains, in order to make the owner whole. And then burn down the whole building and the terrible beast within it. Thus, no one will have to endanger his or her life. This is no time for thinking of expenses, and greediness is unnecessary." All of the townsfolk agreed with him. So they set fire to the barn at all four corners, and with it, the owl was miserably burnt. The end. Yeah, not really a happy ending, right? But I think it's a good message to not try to destroy things out of fear or lack of understanding. Something to contemplate for our own lives. Well, here's another pillow if you need it. I see you're all cozy up in there though, so I'll let you get to sleep.